invite you to stand as we call one another to worship. Happy are those who make the Lord their trust.
The Lord says to Jesus and to us, "You are my servant, in whom I will be glorified."
Jesus calls us to follow him so that we can summon others also to ministry.
God has appointed Jesus and us as a light to the nations, so that God's salvation may reach to the ends of the earth.
You may be seated. Thank you, choir. Let us pray together.
God of grace, we thank you for the opportunity to follow Jesus. Accept our hesitation to be open to all the changes it means to be his followers. Give us courage to allow him to transform our lives. Make us aware again of his amazing power to bring life, hope, and peace even to us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
I invite the boys and girls to come forward. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to see all of you today. You're kind of studying the soup. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Huh? Cream of mushroom, are you looking at?
Well, soy sauce.
Soy? Oh, well, some that might taste good with soup. Okay. Hey. Today on your little bulletins that you get to take with you after our time together, there's a word that sometimes is the answer and sometimes is used, and it's repent. Repent. Does anybody know what repent means? What does repent mean, Dimitri?
Like acknowledging sins, saying that you'll try not to sin again.
Right. That is acknowledging your sin and saying you're going to try not to do that again. One of the Bibles I like to use sometime says it in a little different way. Instead of saying repent, it says change your hearts and lives. Huh. Change your hearts and lives. That's not so easy, right? To change how we do things, to change our ways. You know, that's exactly what repent means. It means to change our ways. Have any of you tried to change your ways? What are some of the ways you've tried to change? Yes.
Like maybe instead of riding my bike, like sitting down and pushing down, maybe try standing up so you have more leg room.
More leg room on a bike if you stand up. Yes, what's another way that you've tried to change? Organizing your clothes and it didn't work. I've tried that too. I want all the black clothes over here and I want all the blue ones over here. Would make it a lot easier. Yes? To separate it would be very good. Yes? Got it.
Doesn't work.
Got it. He says he's trying to get out of bed earlier. And it's not working, and I agree. Completely.
The more tired you're going to be in the morning.
I don't think so.
The more tired you get to sleep, the less tired you're going to get.
Right, usually.
Not when you get to go.
Nikolai?
Okay.
Yes, if you stay too... Right. You know, sometimes when we make little... Were you going to say something? Yes.
Try playing with
somebody new. You know, when you make those little changes, and I know that those little changes are hard. Way back when I had a class, and the teacher said, if you make one change, it'll help you make other changes. And he said, I want you to think about something that would be just a little change in your life. Do you know what I thought of? Making my bed every morning. It helped. Yes, it was a little change, not a big thing. And I'm still doing it most mornings. Okay. So, making changes... Starting with little things helps us to change so that we can change the way Jesus wants us to change. Jesus is hoping that we will change and follow him. Okay? So I'm proud of you for making the changes you are. Maybe another change. I know, how many of you like to read right before going to bed? How about if you read your fun books? Yeah, your dad reads to you. Oh, I think that's great. How about once in a while reading a Bible story at the same time? Would that be a little change? You read a chapter book? Sounds good. You know, there's chapters in the Bible too. Yeah. Yeah, you know that. Oh, wow. Dimitri, good for you. And someday the rest of you will be reading bigger books.
Mm-hmm. No.
Yeah.
I'm good where I'm at.
Okay. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for helping us to make changes. Help us to make the changes that will make a difference in how we love you and love others. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Thanks. So today we're reading from the Gospel of Matthew again. And this reading is Matthew 4, chapter 4, verses 4 to 23. I'm going to talk a little bit about the text before I read it so that when I read it, you might hear it differently. So I would like for us to remember that before Jesus calls to us, he is called again by God. He's again called by God as he was when he was baptized. This is my beloved. So here the beloved is asked or told or does on his own. Jesus now takes the initiative to move to Capernaum, which is a community on the sea. It is a place where there has been warfare over its history. It's a place where they would not have expected the Messiah to come. The Messiah would have been expected to be in Jerusalem, not in this little place in Galilee. And so Jesus moved to Galilee, a city by the sea in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali. And Zebulun and Naphtali were already named in Isaiah as places of darkness, where life had been difficult. I wonder today if you might remember other places where life has been difficult, maybe recently. And recently I'm thinking of Ukraine and the hardships that they have known now for a year, but many years. We already know that they are a faithful people. They take seriously their religion. We heard that again last week when we heard about their worshiping together on Epiphany and celebrating Epiphany. We know that they will long yearn for peace and that the Messiah would come and renew their hope and again remind them of God's presence among them. I not so long ago watched the movie Harriet, about Harriet Tubman. She was one of the ones who helped the people, the slaves in the 1800s find their way to the North. What caught me in the movie and in the story, and you know, many of us know the story because we've read it, is how the slaves, when they gathered together, they often worshiped God. They sang songs that their masters did not understand were songs of faith and songs that will lead them to freedom. And Harriet Tubman was one of those who listened very carefully to what God was saying to her and when she should go in what direction. She was always looking in the darkness for the light. Always in the darkness, she was looking for the light, watching for her understanding of the Messiah to lead her. I mentioned a few minutes ago that there was a shooting in the Asian American community. I think it was called Monterey in California. We have a number of United Church of Christ churches that are Asian American, and I would have no doubt that there might be some there in that community. I have no doubt that they are feeling the darkness this morning. I have no doubt that they have been feeling the darkness since the beginning of COVID, when people from the Asian areas were blamed for what has come to many of us. They are people who are looking for a Messiah, for light in the darkness. There may be places that we too are looking for light in our darkness. Places where you desperately, times when you desperately need to see the light of Christ. Jesus went to Capernaum after John the Baptist had been arrested for his teachings and actions. Jesus already realized his fate could be similar. Yet Jesus had work to do. And so he called his followers to leave their homes as he had left his. And then Jesus announced that things were going to change. God's reign was coming near. The kingdom of heaven was coming near. Now, the kingdom of heaven, we might think of, you know, that eternal life. And I loved the way the choir sang, "Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus here on earth." Did you hear it? "When I wake up. And give me Jesus when I die. And all the places in between, when I am alone, when I'm feeling the hardships, give me Jesus." Jesus went to Capernaum and announced that things were going to change. God's power would become manifest. And as Jesus turned away from where he was, so the people of Capernaum needed to move around, turn away. As I said to the children, those who heard Jesus would need to change their hearts and lives. So we hear this scripture now from Matthew. Where is it in our lives, in our country, in our world, in our particular individual lives, in our church? Where is it that we are called to repent, to change our lives and our hearts? As Jesus calls us, hear these words from Matthew 4, beginning at verse 12. "Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum, by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali. So that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." Then as Jesus walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed Jesus. As Jesus went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. And he called to them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So Jesus has moved into Galilee. And now he's walking by the lake and he sees two brothers. And calls them to follow him. And he calls two others as well. One of the things that caught me this week as I was reading and studying this text is Jesus does not call the disciples by their names. He doesn't say, "Peter, Andrew, follow me." He doesn't say, "James, John, follow me." He says, "Follow me." And I thought that was interesting. We know their names because Matthew tells us the names. But Jesus doesn't use the names. And I wonder if Matthew is trying to tell us that Jesus calls all of us. It's not just these two and those four names. It's our names as well. The beloved says to us, "Follow me." As I've been saying these last weeks, I believe that we all have a calling to follow. The church has a calling to follow. I wish I could say, "Okay, Lynn, this is your calling, and Kay, this is your calling. I can see some of your gifts, but I'm not sure what Jesus says exactly for you, any of you, to do." And yet, in the season of Epiphany, when Jesus calls us again, I think it is time for us to take seriously that call and wonder, what is it that God calls us to do, and who does God call us to be? We don't hear a lot about what the disciples, we hear later what they do, but not as they're following Jesus, except that they are still learning. They are still hearing from him what he is teaching in the synagogues and how he is proclaiming the good news. They see him doing his miraculous works of healing, giving hope to people. I think for us, we also need to be paying attention to what is Jesus doing among us, and to notice that, and then to begin to listen for what the Holy Spirit calls us to do. Now, you may already be doing it. You may already be doing exactly what Jesus wants you to do. I got a feeling, though, most of us have something where we can change our lives and hearts. I have a feeling that Jesus might have some way that we can make a change in what God has called us to do. I have no doubt about that, actually. But again, I can't tell you what changes you have to make, because it's not going to do any good. You have to make the changes. I don't have control over you. You're the ones. I'm the one who has to do it for ourselves with the help of Jesus. Jesus says, follow me. And then he says, I will make you fishers of people. Jesus will send us out among the people to share the good news, maybe with our words, maybe with our actions, maybe with our lives. How is Jesus calling you? Because, my friends, we too are the beloved, the children of God. And, you know, there's a prayer I like. Say it often. Lord, let me see myself as you see me. A lot of times I look at myself and go, oops. But God still sees also the good. And so we need to remember that as well. Our song, our hymn these weeks is, I am the light of the world. You people, come and follow me. Let's sing it together. It's on your yellow cards.
Thank you.
invite us to turn to our hymnals and the opening cover, and mine doesn't have it. And I know it, but I'd rather have it in front of me. And we will recite the statement of faith. Uh-oh. I think we need to go through the hymnals. Thank you, John. UCC statement of faith.
Okay.
We believe in you, O God, eternal Spirit, God of our Savior Jesus Christ, and our God, and to your deeds we testify. You call the worlds into being, create persons in your own image, and set before each one the ways of life and death. You seek in holy love to save all people from aimlessness and sin. You judge people and nations by your righteous will, declared through the prophets and apostles. In Jesus Christ, the man of Nazareth, our crucified and risen Savior, you have come to us and shared our common lot, conquering sin and death and reconciling the world to yourself. You bestow upon us your Holy Spirit, creating and renewing the Church of Jesus Christ, binding in covenant faithful people of all ages, tongues, and races. You call us into the Church to accept the cost and joy of discipleship, to be your servants in the service of others, to proclaim the gospel to all the world, and to resist the powers of evil, to share in Christ's baptism and be at his table, to join him in his passion and victory. You promise to all who trust you forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace, courage in the struggle for justice and peace, your presence in trial and rejoicing, and eternal life in your realm, which has no end. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto you.
Also, words to remind us that we are a people who are called, a church that is called, a people who are called to worship God and to be in the presence of God, to know Jesus Christ. Let us pray, first in silence. Oh God, we are so grateful that you come into the dark places of the world, the places of physical and mental illness, the places where people are yearning because their emptiness seeks your presence, even if they're unaware. Oh God, we ask that you would be in the dark places of the world, the prisons and the places where war is tearing apart nations. We ask you to be in the communities of our own country where gunfire and violence has separated people and caused them to yearn, for peace as they grieve deeply what they have lost. Oh God, we ask you to come into the darkness and let your light shine. Help us to see hope, and help us, oh God, to repent of our ways, to turn our own lives around, to open our hearts to all who are in need of your presence, and who all are in need of our care, our compassion, our love, and our hope. God, you are faithful. You sent Jesus into the world to help us to know how to live. Give us the courage to follow him and his ways. Help us to learn what it is that he so strove to teach us. Help us to know his healing presence and the comfort of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, and as Jesus, we pray as Jesus taught us,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
God is indeed faithful. Let us respond to the goodness of our Lord and Savior with the giving of our gifts, with considering again, what is it God wants us to do? Who is it God wants us to be? Let us pray together.
God, call us to follow Jesus. Help us to follow not only with our hearts and feet, but also through supporting ministry with our time, talent, and treasure. We dedicate the gifts we offer to support the work Jesus calls us to do. Amen.
Our hymn is number 350, The Summons. I don't know if you know this. If you don't, one verse of it and you will know it. It'll be familiar.
Thank you.
May we receive Jesus. As the song said, give me Jesus, means we also need to receive Jesus. And then having received Jesus, are we ready to follow him? So many ways that we can follow Jesus. So many ways. Let us listen for the guidance of the Holy Spirit so that we know how we are to follow Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.